Ringraziamo appunto la nuova relatrice che viene da Vienna, una storica dell'arte, specialista soprattutto sui rapporti tra la parola e l'immagine in ambito ovviamente artistico-culturale, in particolar modo anche e soprattutto della realtà culturale austriaca. Ha insegnato in varie università, tra cui Linz, e dal 2013, come mi raccontava prima, proprio ha ricostruito, come da, possiamo dire, da zero ex novo, quello che è il Museo del Duomo di Vienna. Quindi un'esperienza, possiamo dire, che tramite quindi la teoria si passa anche proprio alla pratica. Infatti, appunto, anche qui mi raccontava che anche nei suoi corsi universitari ovviamente c'è sempre un momento di visita e di consapevolezza concreta dei risultati da compiere all'interno di un museo. Quindi lasciamo la parola alla professoressa in questo suo contributo dal titolo The Language of Ecclesiastical Museums, The Relationship with Contemporary Art. Grazie.
Grazie. Buona giornata a tutti, mille grazie per il cordiale saluti e per avermi invitata a tenere questa lezione. Va bene così?
Sì.
Sono contenta che posso presentare il lavoro di successo del Dom Museum Vienna. Devo dire che capisco un po' italiano, ma non parlo bene. Scusatemi, ma per questo adesso continuo la mia lezione in inglese. Vienna is a Catholic influenced and at the same time historical and contemporary European city, which is also very multiculturally oriented. In my opinion, our Mediatori Museum engagement in the heart of that city suits the reflection and demands of the circular letter, the pastoral function of ecclesiastical museums, very well. After all, it states that it is about the consideration of the works of the past in reference to cultural and ecclesiastical experience today, as well as meetings between believers and non-believers, and inspiring young people towards the culture of memory and the history of Christianity. How can a newly designed ecclesiastical museum be successful in a city like Vienna, which has numerous first-class museums and cultural venues, like Albertina, Belvedere, you know them? How can it become an indispensable emotional place of repose and at the same time a socio-politically relevant discursive platform? How can it appeal equally to people of different cultures, religions, and age groups? How can it sensitize them to the central themes of Christianity, themes like human vulnerability, combating social inequality, and the relationship between human and the environment, which are just as relevant today as they were 2,000 years ago? These were questions that arose when Dom Museum Wien was being completely reconceptualized and overhauled architecturally from 2013 to 2017. The original museum was founded in 1933 and at the time was oriented exclusively towards history, as you see in this picture. It was closed in 2012 by His Eminence Cardinal Schönborn and Vicar General Graser in order to realize the plan of the Archdiocese to build an entirely new contemporary museum. When I read the job description for the position of the director who was to carry out the reconstruction and redesigning, I thought to myself, what a field of tension, what an opportunity for the church and art to become effective in society through a very special museum top-class distinctive exhibitions and socially and creatively oriented mediation projects because the conditions were perfect. A location in the center of the city, in a historical building with characteristic Viennese flair right next door to the Episcopal Palace, with diverse views of the city's religious center and the country's landmark, St. Stephen's Cathedral. Stocked with rich collection holdings and permanent loans dating back to the Middle Ages. Among the many highlights of the collection are the legendary portrait of the Habsburg Rudolf the Founder, considered the oldest three-quarter view portrait in the West. The outstanding Vierge of Rente, a shrine Madonna from the early 15th century, which can be opened like the carved wing altar and contains the Trinity. Or the reliquary of St. Leopold from 1588, which contains his pelvic bones. The exhibits originate from the Dommuseum Wien's collection, St. Stephen's Cathedral, and other ecclesiastic institutions of the Archdiocese of Vienna. The sculptures, altar pieces, liturgical equipment, manuscripts, and drawings bear witness to the fact that the Catholic Church was one of the most important patrons of European artistic development for over 2,000 years. They also reflect the fact that the dialogue between art and the Church never completely broke off in the 20th century. This is illustrated, for example, by the activities of the preacher, art connoisseur and collector Monsignore Otto Maurer, who in 1972, in the context of his noteworthy international conversation on art, said programmatically, "When the Church decides to once again cast its fate with contemporary art, that is when charisma will emerge." Otto Maurer ran the Galerie Next St. Stephan in post-war Vienna, which became the most important avant-garde center in the country. Maurer was convinced that society and the Church had nothing more pressing to do than to confront the drastic, pictorial, eloquent expressions of the critical spirit of our time. He said, "The Church should know which time it is living in, with which world it is speaking, and to which world it is directed and sent to." Otto Maurer's art collection of over 3,000 works of modern and contemporary art was donated to Dommuseum Wien in 1980. It includes works by Gustav Klimt, Oskar Kokoschka, Joseph Beuys, Maria Lasnik, and many other artists who are now in great demand internationally. Promoting contemporary art through commissions or acquisitions has played a central role in the museum's reorientation since its relaunch, coupled with the physical expansion of the museum space into the public arena or neighboring sacred spaces. So, for example, the painter, designer, and sculptor Leo Zogmeier designed stools for the Dommuseum Wien that are a combination of multifunctional pieces of furniture and word art, chair sculptures that are mainly used at discursive events in the building or for creative workshops. The furniture itself also encourages discourse. The names of various male and female saints in different languages, such as Francesco, Katharina, and István, are carved out of the different colored plastic cross pieces of the stools. names that are closely related to the collection's holdings. Projects that took place during the museum's reconstruction phase were especially sensational. For example, the artist Johanna Kandel's painterly intervention close to the text at the construction site behind the museum referred to one of the most important art historical exhibits from the cathedral treasury. The legendary shroud of the innovative ruler and founder Rudolf IV, who died prematurely in 1365. It is still not clear how this silk fabric, interwoven with gilded silver threads, which was made in Iran for a ruling Muslim sultan, came into the sphere of the person who founded the Vienna University and who initiated St. Stephen's Cathedral extension. Equally, we don't know what motivated its use as a burial shroud. Johanna Kandel's work raised several questions about the relationship of history and the present, both content-wise and in terms of the media. How did it come to be that a deceased Christian duke had a shroud tailored on his body, covered with Arabic script, and paying tribute to a sultan? What changes occur when a late medieval Oriental fabric is suddenly translated into a painting and quoted in a 21st century public space at a building site? By translating it into the painterly language of the present and positioning it in the middle of a public arena at a building site, it was possible to break down barriers that are often associated with a visit to a museum. Immense interest in the historical ecclesiastical treasures arose, even among people who normally don't go to a cathedral museum. In addition, in the middle of the center of Vienna, many conversations between people of different cultures and religions developed, so that, even without being open, the museum became an important place of encounter. A central trademark of our museum is the direct juxtaposition of historical objects and contemporary art, also of the sacred and the profane, in areas of the permanent collection on display. This is precisely how we succeed in showing how closely history and the present are interconnected, and what relevance Christian iconography and Christian themes still have today. One of our showcases, which you see here, especially often depicted in the media and publications, is one with a wonderful root of Jesse monstrance from 1630, a theologically and aesthetically outstanding testimony of Baroque production. On the base and behind the monstrance, we find a fine contemporary drawing on double-layered transparent paper. It was done by the Austrian artist Iris Andraschek when the monstrance was disassembled in 400 individual parts for restoration. On the background medium, the individual parts of the liturgical object spread out explosively. The young woman at the top right of the picture, from whom this world seems to emanate, holds banners with biblical quotations and excerpts from the restoration description of the monstrance in her clenched fist. This creates connections to contemporary issues, such as current political events and the humanitarian drama of the war in Syria. Because, as the artist emphasizes through the Latin title of the work, the root of Jesse contains the hope that the Messiah, who comes from it, will not only offer eschatological salvation, but also earthly peace and homecoming for displaced people. Our thematic exhibitions, which change once a year and encompass half the museum, are a special venue for the relationship between the present and the past, between contemporary art and historical sacred art. These exhibitions explore cross-epochal themes that are universally relevant from an artistic and a theological as well as a socio-political perspective. The titles of the last three presentations alone, which I would now like to introduce to you through selected exhibition images, illustrate how topical and explosive these themes are. Show Me Your Wound, Family Matters, and Fragile Creation. The objects in our exhibitions are arranged neither iconographically nor chronologically. Our intention is not to illustrate theoretical considerations through works of art. Rather, the aim is to encourage visitors to reflect on central themes of the human condition. These themes traverse the history of Christianity and remain highly relevant today. Our exhibition designs are associative and sometimes deliberately contrastive. If visitors leave Dom Museum Wien with more questions than answers, then that is more that we can hope for. A further essential concern of our exhibitions is to show how similar the questions are that artists of different eras deal with. However, the formal answers may turn out quite differently depending on the development of art and the will to create art. The conception of the exhibitions is based on a combination of aesthetic and thematic juxtapositions and groupings. Sometimes sacred and profane, medieval and contemporary works enter into a harmonious dialogue with each other. Sometimes they collide harshly and irritate. Regular ruptures between them are deliberately created. The exhibitions are dedicated neither to a single era, not to a single medium, rather with sculptures, paintings, drawings, photographs, and video installations, they span a wide range from the early Middle Ages to contemporary art. The inclusion of numerous contemporary artists and works created especially for our shows also plays a special role here, emphasizing the position of the church as a patron of contemporary art. The exhibition Show Me Your Wound became even more topical in retrospect due to the coronavirus pandemic. It made clear how current the themes of our shows are. In this exhibition, we concentrated on artistic representations of physical, psychological, and socio-political wounds. As always, we did this against the background of the Christian pictorial tradition and the story of Jesus' suffering. The central painting in the main room of the show, which was about the politics of wounding, was a late classicist crucifixion. A painting that in several respects, not only iconographically, but also physically, has to do with wounding, for it was slashed by National Socialists during the storming of the Episcopal Palace in 1938. You can see here these woundings. Works by contemporary artists were assembled around this historic document, such as the bomb suit by the Swedish sculptor Andres Krisa, who can be seen lying on the floor in the photo, or the sculpture by the Lebanese artist Lamia Shoreji on the left of the picture, which deals with the destruction of a museum in Beirut during the Civil War. They demonstrate that wounding is often the result of power struggles and violent confrontations related to political, religious, or gender oppression. But the visitors did not end the tour of this show in suffering. Rather, in a chapter entitled Celebrating the Wound, the exhibition demonstrated the sensuality and cleansing power that can be owed by wounds, and above all, blood, using the painting Blood of Christ by Giovanni Cortese, which was surrounded by two contemporary works, including one by Lucio Fontana. The fact that mental and physical wounds only heal when people actively participate in their healing was made tangible by the SCAR project by the Canadian artist Nadia Mir. In an interactive installation, visitors were invited to show their own wounds by embroidering their personal wounds and scars on a small canvas and thus enrich the exhibition with their own stories. In Family Matters, we again use contrasting juxtapositions between works from the most diverse art eras. We made it possible to experience what family can be as a setting for the most diverse emotions, what family means personally to each visitor. The exhibition ran precisely during the first pandemic-related lockdown in spring 2020. Many people were spending the whole day, as we know, with their families, often in cramped quarters at home. So the exhibition met with great media response, although it could only partly be conveyed online. Both the objects shown and the way the exhibition spaces were designed stimulated reflection on how closely family images are linked to historical and socio-political developments, and how they have also repeatedly changed. In one room, for example, visitors were confronted with an abundance of family portraits from the most diverse times. Iconic paintings by historical artists such as Jacopo Palma il Vecchio, Ferdinand Georg Waldmüller, and Angelika Kaufmann hang on one wall in a so-called Petersburg arrangement. They conveyed an impression of the different functions that family portraits have had throughout history, and in particular illuminated the constellation of the Holy Family, as in the painting of the Holy Kinship by Dirk Wellert. The opposite wall shifted the gaze from history to the immediate present and comprised 12 large format photographs by artist Katharina Meyer, who has been working on the depiction of family-style living communities for 20 years. We were particularly interested in Maya's photographs because they illustrate the diversification of family in the present in an incomparable way, depicting affluent families as well as refugee families. A particular highlight in the exhibition area, relationship and emotions, was the juxtaposition of an exceptionally crafted stone Madonna from the early 14th century and a modern sculpture by the Australian contemporary sculptor Sam Jinks. The irritating hyper-realistic sculpture left the question open whether a grandmother or a very old mother was being depicted. Here, association with biblical stories and the figure of Sarah, for example, were aroused just as much as contemporary discussions about late motherhood in the wake of new medical developments. Our current show, which deals with the relationship between man and nature, the tender as well as the destructive aspects, with reference to Pope Francis' encyclical Laudato Si, also comprises tense confrontations. Visitors are spellbound in front of an impressive Renaissance painting by the 16th century painter Alessandro Araldi from Parma, which we have placed at the beginning of the exhibition. Here, the religious motif of a Sacra Conversazione shares equal space with a landscape depiction, a novelty in Renaissance art that led to change in humans' view of the sacred as well of nature. The 2007 work Nursery by the American artist Mark Dyan is presented just in front of it. The old-fashioned baby carriage contains live plants instead of an infant. With a twinkle in his eye, the artist immediately lets us know that this installation is about humans' ethical responsibility for flora, although it also points the parallels between caring for, raising, disciplining, and cultivating human, as well as plant offspring. Without having to explain it through texts, references between the crib and the carriage, between the sacred theme of the Sacra Conversazione and the current questions surrounding environmental responsibility open up when we look at these works together. Elsewhere, an imposing liturgical vestment draws the eye. This piece, which occupies the center of the spirit and nature room, is one of the most magnificent chasuble from St. Stephen's Cathedral in Vienna, and part of the Kolonitz regalia created around 1740. Embroidered all over with floral ornaments, it stands for the Baroque praise of the multiformity and beauty of creation, visible to all the faithful on the priest's body during the liturgical event. Subtle works from history, the avant-garde, and the present by artists such as Josef Beuys, Arnulf Reiner, and Neil Bagüresch surround the vestment. They illustrate how much the human mind has always worked on the concept of nature, and how unmistakably the vegetable language of form and moments of fauna are inscribed in the world of pictures and book. But the works also illustrate the reverse, how man becomes a competitive creative counterpart to what has grown organically, by trying to imitate or produce nature artificially. This aspect is emphasized by the Swiss artist Regula Detwiller, who captures disassembled plastic flowers made in Asia in fine watercolors, and does so with the same dedication that artists of past centuries displayed in their studies of real plants. 5 minutes, that's okay?
No, no.
Oh, okay. Okay. Yeah, okay. Then let me make a short conclusion. This is about our mediation project. So let me conclude by returning to the beginning of my talk and to the question I asked myself in the course of the new conception of this museum. At that time, it was clear to me that it wouldn't be easy to establish a new ecclesiastical museum in the midst of Vienna's rich museums landscape, which is situated between tradition and the present, between the church and the art. I had in mind a museum that would be a mediative oasis of calm amid the city's consumerist frenzy and at the same time a lively, discursive place. A space for reflection, which some visit to see a Gothic Madonna and discover how touching a video by a contemporary artist about a Syrian refugee boy is, while others pause in awe in front of a late Baroque Mary Magdalene, although they have actually come because of an environmental activist contemporary installation. Especially an ecclesiastical museum should become a bridge in a society increasingly marked by divisions and should act as a platform that brings together people from different cultures, religious, social, and biographical backgrounds. Very quickly, the museum took shape in my mind as a vivid image in the form of a special church museum with an unmistakable profile as a response to numerous urgent challenges of the present. In 2017, this museum became a reality, and it is reflected in the lively response of visitors and the media during the last 4 years. It culminated in our nomination for the European Museum Award and our receiving the Austrian Museum Award 2020, the highest national award for the museums. The success of Dommuseum Wien is confirmation of the fact that society, today more than ever, needs ecclesiastical museums and their pastoral effect as intermediaries between the past, the present, and the future, especially when they build a bridge to the present by incorporating advanced contemporary art and use the creative power of art for pastoral work. In the spirit of Monsignor Otto Mauer, who was not only convinced that art brings something creative to Christianity, but also referred to the transformational power of art in his famous speech about Joseph Beuys. He said, "Art changes people, it changes life, it changes the world." Grazie.